Good morning. Scott Davis here one more time with cheerful greetings for all the members and friends of Forest Hill United Church. The others on our worship team, Reverend Ellen, Reverend Gary, and MJ, are also glad you're able to join us online today. Have you been counting? This is week 5 of me wearing the same shirt and pants, and I'm about ready to crack. Oh, there, now I feel like a new presider. Silliness aside, this happened because we taped several introductory welcomes the day before the lockdown began on January 14th, so we could safeguard our valued lay leaders. This is the final week my scruffiness will welcome you to worship. Thanks for your indulgence and for not fast-forwarding to the good stuff. Let me offer deep thanks for your dedicated support of the ministry at Forest Hill United. We also welcome those who are new to our community and offer a few suggestions on ways you can support our ministry at Forest Hill, as well as our sustained efforts to help the lonely and needy of our world. Don't forget to review the week's announcements following the service or read them on our webpage or in the latest messenger. There is information on the ongoing spirit circles facilitated by Reverend Ellen, as well as opportunities to network with others in our Forest Hill community. Kelly, our wonderful administrator, checks emails and phone calls Monday to Friday. For urgent matters and emergencies, kindly call Reverend Gary or Reverend Ellen directly. Today, we explore the fourth and final of Don Miguel Ruiz's 4 agreements. Agreement 4, always do your best. As a former Cub leader at Forest Hill, this one really resonates with me, since do your best is the Wolf Cub motto. And now, let's move into today's worship with music MJ will announce for us.
We move into the rest of our service today with a moment of reflective music.
Our first act of worship today is to acknowledge the land. May the words of our land acknowledgement be truthful and hopeful. We acknowledge that we live, work, and worship God on the historic traditional territory of the Haudenosaunee, Anishinaabe, Neutral Nation, and the Mississaugas of New Credit. By force, these people were robbed of their land and denied their culture. Our prayer is that, with the power of love, we find ways to share the land and celebrate the cultures of all who call this land home. May our acknowledgement of truth be but the first step towards reconciliation between the first peoples of the land and all who come later.
Thank you, Scott, for introducing our Sunday this morning. We have seen you in your shirt, even wearing it to coffee and conversation, so we didn't forget what you looked like. And we just appreciate your stepping up and giving us a hand. Good morning to all of you this morning. Just a little reminder that Reverend Gary is away this week for a well-deserved time of spiritual renewal. So we're going to start our candle lighting this morning with our sign language, which is from chaos to creation. And this Sunday is the second Sunday of Black History Month. As well as acknowledging the systemic injury to our First Nations people, we light these candles this morning, acknowledging the injustice to all those who are seen to be other than us. Knowing that these candles are reminding us of the presence of the Holy Light. These candles allow us to look back with courage. The light of these candles helps us to face the truth that God reveals to us. The light of these candles shines with hope. The light of these candles helps us to look to the future to see possibilities growing from the seeds of lessons learned this month and all time. This is God's light and leads us from chaos to creation. Amen. And our memorial candles this morning first candle we're going to light is our candle of hope. Of course, we've heard that the possibility of us being out of lockdown is pretty close, but we still have to remember to be prudent and diligent in our care. And so we just hope that we are seeing light at the end of the tunnel. Our first memorial candle this morning is lit for Joyce Johnson, whose son Richard died this week as a result of COVID. And we light the candle in remembrance of all those who are still at the effect of the COVID virus. Second memorial candle we're lighting is for Bob and Elliot's brother-in-law, Graham Craig, also who died this past week. And we remember Sharon and Bob as they experience the changes in their lives. Our third memorial candle this morning is in memory of Wolfgang Rattenberg, Diane's husband, who died 3 years ago today on Valentine's Day, which also happened to be the anniversary of 45 years of marriage with Diane and Wolfgang. And our fourth candle, memorial candle we're lighting, is in memory of Vi Cook. Many of you will know that she has been an avid bridge player. The last time I saw her, we were doing communion out in the parking lot in the fall. And there she was at 103 having communion with us. So we just remember her. Thinking of you this morning, we're lighting the candle for our beloved Heidi, the trusted companion and support of Judy Funkenhauser. Heidi underwent surgery this week and will be recuperating at home, and we just ask for a speedy recovery for Heidi. And the other part of the thinking of you candle is for the House of Friendship, which experienced a very large fire at the Waterloo Inn, and the House of Friendship has been a shelter for people who needed to be isolated during the COVID time. So we just think of those who have been displaced. Today's call to worship and prayers are adapted from the writings of the Reverend Wilson Ganache of the Burgeo Pastoral Charge in Newfoundland and Labrador. And it's based on Isaiah 41 and 42. You whom I have taken from the end of the earth and called from its furthest regions, and to whom I have said, you are my children. I have chosen you and have not forgotten you. Behold my people whom I uphold, my chosen ones in whom my soul delights. I have put my spirit upon you. You will bring justice to the world. You will bring forth justice for truth. You will not fail or be discouraged till you have brought justice in the earth. I, the Lord, have called you in righteousness and will hold your hand. I will keep you and give you as a covenant to the people, as a light to the world, to open blind eyes, to bring prisoners from prison. For sure I am the Lord, that is my name, and my glory I will not give to another. Behold, the former things that have come to pass, and new things I declare.
Today's scripture is Luke chapter 10, verses 25 to 37, the parable of the Good Samaritan. A teacher of the law came up and tried to trap Jesus. "Teacher," he asked, "what must I do to receive eternal life?" Jesus answered him, "What do the scriptures say? How do you interpret them?" The man answered, "Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your strength, and with all your mind. And love your neighbor as you love yourself." "You are right," Jesus replied. "Do this and you will live." But the teacher of the law wanted to justify himself. So he asked Jesus, "Who is my neighbor?" Jesus answered, "There was once a man who was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho when robbers attacked him, stripped him, and beat him up, leaving him half dead. It so happened that a priest was going down that road. But when he saw the man, he walked on by on the other side. In the same way, a Levite also came along, walked over and looked at the man, and then walked on by on the other side. But a Samaritan who was traveling that way came upon the man, and when he saw him, his heart was filled with pity. He went over to the man, poured oil and wine on his wounds, and bandaged them. Then he put the man on his own animal and took him to an inn, where he took care of him. The next day, he took out 2 silver coins and gave them to the innkeeper. 'Take care of him,' he told the innkeeper, 'and when I come back this way, I will pay you whatever else you spend on him.'" And Jesus concluded, "In your opinion, which of these 3 acted like a neighbor towards the man attacked by the robbers?" The teacher of the law answered, "The one who was kind to him." Jesus replied, "You go then and you do the same."
Please join in singing in Voices United, number 299, "Teach Me, God, to Wonder."
Teach me, God, to wonder. Teach me, God, to see. Life be
Just last week, I saw a Blondie cartoon that made me laugh because for me, it illustrated in a very humorous way just what the Four Agreements are all about. Dagwood and Blondie are sitting at 90 degrees to each other. And Dagwood says, "I can't believe you said that." To which Blondie replies, "Stop yelling at me." Followed by Dagwood, "I'm not yelling." To which Blondie replies, "Okay, then I don't like your tone." Dagwood then retorts, "What tone would you prefer I would use?" And Blondie then replies, "Well, for starts, one that agrees with me." These past few or 4 weeks, as Scott said, we've been taking a look at the writing of Don Luis Miguel's Four Agreements, both in Sunday service and in our spirit circle. You'll notice the agreements are still there. The first one is be impeccable with your words, and impeccable coming from the word without sin. Second agreement is let things let go, or don't take things personally. Third agreement is don't make assumptions. And today we will conclude with the series with a look at the fourth agreement, always do your best. In the cartoon, I noticed that the dog is lying quietly beside Dagmar's chair, Dagwood's chair, perhaps doing his best not to get involved in the conversation going on between Dagwood and Blondie. Today, my hope is to try and put into perspective how these agreements work together in complex simplicity, not just for our own spiritual well-being, where any change takes place, but for the health and well-being of all our relationships. Just this week, someone in the spirit circle commented that we could spend much more time digging into these short, succinct statements, because it seemed like we were just scratching the surface. And I can attest that that's true. I first met Don Miguel and got my copy of the book in 2001. And over the years, it has helped to remind me when I have gone off course and found myself wondering about my relationships with myself, with God, and with others. Today's scripture reading that Rhonda read earlier is a long-standing familiar parable that most of us learned growing up in Sunday school. I dare say most of us could recite it by heart, "Do unto others as you would have them do unto you, and love your neighbors and others as yourself." It is the essence of every loving kindness and compassion in how we treat ourselves that is embedded in a plethora of spiritual traditions. One might say that it is a rock traditional agreement that some might call letter of law, or as Don Miguel calls it, the book of law, the book of our law. That we are encouraged to live by. The four agreements are an inside job. What we hold and value inside our spiritual nature is what we mirror out into the larger world. It begs the question for each and every one of us, what does it mean for me to put that wisdom into action as an adult in the context in which I'm living right now? How does it call us to be more actively participating in the issues such as white privilege, food security, supportive housing, learning more about our Indigenous people or our Black brothers and sisters? Perhaps we're being called to get a better understanding of others who are struggling with emotional, physical, or mental challenges. Don Miguel challenges us to examine what assumptions we carry, what past agreements, our beliefs, our past beliefs and attitudes that we've held on to, that we might be willing to let go of, or at least loosen our grip for the greater good of living out God's mission in the world today. In today's passage, we are told the two traveling religious leaders seem to hold tight to their traditional agreement of, "That's not mine to do," as they walked away or around the stranger. And the third traveler, a Samaritan, and other, as we have come to call them, offered help seemingly without any yeah buts or hesitations. So a question that comes to my mind is, how does each of their actions reflect the agreements they have made about their purpose in life? On a quick read, this parable may seem to appeal to the surface level, often simplistic theology, until we dig a little deeper into what it really entails in our living, just as we have been doing through the four agreements. Notice that there is a subtle directive tone in this passage, which we can very easily gloss over. Douglas John Hall, a noted theologian, calls these divine imperatives. Notice the verb, do it and you'll live. Love your neighbor as well as you do yourself. Jesus doesn't couch it in niceties like, well, if I have time, or if it isn't going to be an inconvenience to me, or, well, if you don't mind. Rather, Jesus says, just do it, like the Nike slogan. So very often we can forget that our words are more than just symbols. They have a force behind them. Who would not have wished to take back some words that came out in the heat of a moment? Or wished we had said something or done something when in fact we had kept quiet? And who amongst us has not beat themselves up with some negative, life-draining self-criticism? If we scratch past the surface level of this parable and take time to reflect on what loving ourselves and our neighbors really looks like, I would suggest that the four agreements are implied in Jesus' imperatives and offers us a very tangible plan of action. The last agreement, the fourth agreement, is about the action of living fully the first three. It sets the bar as a very high divine imperative, doesn't it? Always do your best. I often find myself coming up with a yeah but when I'm challenged with always doing the best myself. And I think it's the word always that sticks in my throat and sputters as I try to say something. And there are a few cautions about the agreement of always doing your best, because it has so many complex levels of interpretation and situations. First of all, do your best is not very easy a whole lot of the time. And it will never be the same from one moment to the next, because everything we do, everything that we are, including ourselves, is changing all the time. From the time you get up in the morning to the time you go to the bed. We think things are the same, but in fact, we're not. And the context of where we are in the difference between the morning and the evening are different. Secondly, what I might think is always doing my best may not fit your picture of me always doing my best. For example, my rhubarb custard pie might not and probably won't fit your description of a good rhubarb custard pie. Or I might have done what I thought was a really good job of cleaning out a closet, only to have you have a look and find some pieces of garbage still lying around. I thought I was doing my best. Thirdly, We do well to have a look at why we are doing something. What agreements are we holding tight to? While doing our best is admirable and a very great value, is it because it is something we love to do? Perhaps it's a passion that enhances our zest for living. Something that just feels right and brings us joy. Like the paintings that Shelley shared with us on her Facebook pages. That's a passion. You can see that in her artwork. Or is it a life-draining assumption that easily slides into a have-to and based on an old agreement that we have not taken and dusted off? We can fall into that one very, very quickly and easily. It can be a slippery slope from something we enjoy doing to something that becomes a have-to. And there's a difference of doing our best in each of those situations. So perhaps we might also boast, well, of course, I always do my best, only to feel that little niggle that we can when in the pit of our stomach when we know that we really have missed the mark. And your body says, you think so? Brené Brown says that it's quite okay that to be vulnerable, to feel hurt, and to be afraid, to let go of your agreements that you have held and that may not be sitting too well with you anymore. Those agreements with the judge and the victim who live inside of us, we all have them. And for me, that word always is the heavy-hitting word in this agreement. Truth be told, we all know when we aren't doing our best. However, when we admit it to ourselves and perhaps to others, we are being impeccable with our words. We are not covering up or being dishonest with ourselves. Always doing our best is being honest, even when we're not doing our best. And that is a hard place, isn't it? How many times have you felt a rush of relief when you have admitted that it really wasn't your best, that you weren't doing your best? Perhaps there's a time when you've had to ask for forgiveness or missed the mark of saying or doing something from a better choice, from a healthier choice. We live in a flux, a roller coaster of time, especially right now this past year when we have been involved in this pandemic. So many people are experiencing mental and physical challenges, emotional challenges, with moods that can overtake us in a flash, in the very best of times. The call to always doing our best when feeling life is out of our control has been tested over and over in all times and in all contexts. Sometimes we feel like we are the only generation experience this until you talk to someone who has lived through another generational challenge of time, something like a pandemic or like a disease that has hit, like scarlet fever or swine flu. We forget that other people have had to do their best in times like that. Sometimes the simplest of things is the best that we can do. And we're doing our best when we acknowledge this. These four agreements that we've been talking about hold out to us a very tangible way to honor and respect our God-given self and everyone God has placed in our lives. The four agreements show us how to love ourselves so that we can live into Jesus' divine imperative to treat and love others as we want to be treated and loved. Don Miguel notes that the first three agreements will only work if we do our best. that it is learning to accept ourselves as we acknowledge our missteps. Our lived experience then becomes our own creation as we become aware of and break our old agreements that we have adopted from the way we were brought up, or something we've heard that from our parents, but somehow doesn't fit with who we are and in our lives. Our lived experience is so much richer and full when we create our own agreements rather than those that are chosen for us. Our own self-chosen new agreements become ones that touch our human spirit and encourage us to be free, free as God has created us to be and called us to be, free of self-limiting belief system, free to accept who we are with our warts and all that we all have. Shifting our programming from having to please others, which often results in some very negative feelings, to being true to ourself and to God who loves us and wants the best for us, is about making new agreements based on our own beliefs and values. I built this gender block this morning. It took me back to a game that we used to play as kids, and it reminded me that each of these blocks is the stability and the strength for the whole. And you know, there are times and places when we remove one block and that stability is still held. But then there's that time, that one moment when we take out that one block and the whole thing tumbles and crashes. The four agreements for me are like the Jenga blocks of all our relationships. When we do our best to be impeccable, and when we do our best to not take things personally, when we try not to make assumptions, and we always do the best we can, we are living as God is asking us to do. And our personal relationships are held together with stability. And when that one block comes down and tumbles the whole block into chaos, we can always do our best to build up our new tower of relationships. Don Miguel writes, "God is life. God is life in action. The best way to say, I love you, God, is to live your life by doing your best. The best way to say, thank you, God, is by letting go of the past and living in the present moment, right here and right now. Whatever life takes from you, let it go. Letting go of the past means that you can enjoy what is happening now. Because if you don't, you will always wish it to be different than it is. Don't resist life passing through you, because that is God passing through you. Love your neighbor as yourself is quite the divine imperative. Amen." You're now going to be invited to see a video that's called The Hymn to Freedom. Many of you will know that Canadian jazz musician Oscar Peterson wrote this iconic theme, Hymn to Freedom, in 1962, during a time when the fight for civil rights gained strength in the United States, Canada, and all around the world. This new version of Hymn to Freedom was launched at a concert in Waterloo here on March 22nd, 2019. It is indeed here in this community that we are seeing the tireless drive and passionate work of the Kitchener-Waterloo Multicultural Center to do their very best to break the long-standing, systemic old agreements of racial injustice here in our own community. Please enjoy the video. And now we come together in a time of community prayers. I invite you to ground yourself, set aside things that you're fussing about, worrying about, things you're just thinking about, and just join us in our thoughts and our breath of God as we offer our prayers together. Let us pray. Loving God, we thank you for calling us to you from all the corners of the world to come home to belong. We appreciate your love that embraces all of us. We thank you that we are all one in you. We thank you for your faithfulness and justice. When we were aliens and foreigners, you welcomed us. We give thanks, O God, for calling us into your ministry to live and to do your work with the mind of Christ. Remind us, O God, that we are here to fulfill your calling to serve. May all we do be done for love. During this year's Black History Month, we want to draw closer to you as we make a commitment to go into the world as agents of your justice, your peace, and your reconciliation. And, O gracious God, we need your help to do your work and to fulfill this task that you have given us to do. We are proud to be part of the church that is serving you, and so we humbly lift up our prayers of concern to you. For those who are grieving the loss of loved ones, Diane Rattenberg, Joyce Johnson, Bob and Sharon Elliott, and all others, may they and those who are close to them feel the comfort, your comfort and caring, as their loved ones now take a very special place in your memories. Gracious God, we pray for world peace, especially in the troubled spots of political unrest, and those struggling with such a section, so many places of injustice. We offer our prayers for the speedy, healthy, and full recovery of Judy's Heidi, so that they are able to support one another as they have done for so many years. We give thanks for Paul Vanderkamer's recovery from yet another heart, another recent surgery. In our prayers this morning, O God, we remember Reverend Gary. May his time apart from us offer him the respite and the spiritual nourishment so that he returns to us refreshed. We offer our prayers of support to the congregation of St. Luke's in Cambridge, as they too journey through this COVID time. Gracious God, be with those who have been displaced from the fire at the Waterloo Inn. And now, O God, we lift to you the concerns and challenges of our own hearts in a moment of silence. In Christ's name we pray as we have been taught. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Please join in singing in Voices United, number 684, Make Me a Channel of Your Peace.
As we ready ourselves to close our service, I invite you to go forth in the name of Christ. Fulfill your task as ambassadors and lead the world to justice and peace, all as equal members of God's family. And hearing the words of this poem by Maya Angelou, The Human Family. I note the obvious differences in the human family. Some are serious, some thrive on comedy. Some declare their lives are lived as true perfunctory, and others claim they really live the real reality. The variety of our skin tones can confuse, bemuse, delight. Brown and pink and beige and purple, tan and blue and white. I've sailed upon the seven seas and stopped in every land. I've seen the wonders of the world. Not yet one common man. I know 10,000 women called Jane and Mary Jane, but I've not seen any two who really were the same. Mirror twins are different, although their features jibe, and lovers think quite different thoughts while lying side by side. We love and lose in China. We weep on England's moors and laugh and moan in Guinea and thrive on Spanish shores. We seek success in Finland, are born and die in Maine. In minor ways we differ, in major we're the same. I note the obvious differences between each sort and type, but we are more alike, my friends, than we are unlike. We are more alike, my friends, than we are unalike. Thank you for joining us this morning, joining me this morning. Well, Betty was able to help out with our candle lighting, and I appreciate it. You're welcome to stay on for another episode with Dragon and Gary and I, and perhaps grab another cup of coffee before the annual general meeting begins at 11:30 and on Zoom, which you will have received the link for. So thank you for joining us, and we will see you next week. God bless.
Good morning, everybody. Well, here we are on Valentine's Day, and Dragon and I are here together. It's so good to see you. Oh, yes, Dragon. They're there, and they're looking at us. Mm-hmm.
Oh, gee. Oh. Dragon, yeah. I'm really glad that you brought Gary along today.
Mm-hmm. Oh, what? Dragon is really curious about what are you doing?
Well, I am using my pink marker to make a very large heart.
That's a heart? Dragon wants to know that's a heart?
Yes, that's a heart.
Oh,
absolutely.
That's a heart, Dragon. Oh. And why are you making that heart?
Well, because today, February the 14th, is Valentine's Day.
Dragon's not sure what that means.
Well, it's got a long history, but the short story, Dragon, because I don't think you want the whole big. There was someone called Saint Valentine, and we adopted the Valentine to show people that we love them. It's a way that we could draw a heart, and we can put all kinds of things in that heart, and a way of showing people that we love them. So.
I know, it's a really good idea. You're right, Dragon. Dragon wants to know, what are you going to put in your heart?
Well, I was just thinking about that while we were talking. I'm going to write, I love... Who do you think I love, Dragon?
Dragon doesn't know. It's a mystery.
It's a mystery, and Dragon's being curious. Okay, I love you. Yes, you.
Dragon says no one said that before.
I love you. And do you notice that what I put after the you in at the very end? Do you know what that is, Dragon?
A baseball bat and a ball.
That's a good idea. However, that's very interesting. It's called an exclamation mark. An exclamation mark.
Hmm.
And you know, it changes things. Can you hear the difference between if I say, I love you? Hmm. Do you think you believe me?
It'd be very sad.
Yeah, it's kind of a sad I love you. Not really showing how much... Not showing really what love means. How about if I say, I love you?
Oh, Dragon says now she believes it.
Well, that's what that exclamation mark is for. Yes, it's really exclaiming, saying loud and clear that I love you.
Dragon says she likes that a lot.
Well, I was thinking that I bet there's a whole lot of people that would like to hear that somebody loves them. Would they feel as good as you feel when I say it to you?
Mm-hmm. Dragon thinks probably.
Well, I've just thought of something. I'm going to cut out my heart. And you know, I was thinking I can also add more things on my heart. Things that I love about people. Maybe some of the things I love to do with people. Some of the things that make someone special. For example, I could maybe, if I was, I could draw a picture of you, Dragon, flying through the air. Or, you just gave me another big idea. I think I'm going to put a big smile. Smile. That's your smile. That's a smile for you. And you know what I'm going to do with this, Dragon? What do you think? What could I do with it?
Well, Dragon doesn't know. She's never had a heart before.
Oh, well, I think I'm going to put this one in my window so that anybody goes by my window on a walk as they're doing their exercise, getting the fresh air, they will, if they're feeling a little bit down, they could see this and it would remind them that somebody loves them.
Dragon thinks it's a great idea.
Oh, good, good. Well, I'm going to put it somewhere, Dragon, where you can see it. And every time you see it, you're going to know that I love you and Gary loves you.
Oh, yes, of course. She wants to know that that'll be on there for longer than just one day.
Oh, absolutely, absolutely. Maybe it would be a good idea to keep it on the window until we're out of the COVID.
Dragon likes that idea.
Yeah.
And what? Dragon would like two of them.
Oh, well, that's possible. I could make another one. That's a good idea.
You can
make lots of them.
We'll have to work at some tonight, okay? Is that all right? Okay, Dragon's very excited about making some Valentine hearts.
Wonderful, wonderful. Well, I just want you to remember that we love you.
Oh, it's okay. Don't be shy. All right. Okay. You're okay? All right. Dragon's okay.
We're okay.
Okay. So happy Valentine's Day.
Happy Valentine's to you, Gary.
Happy Valentine's Day, everybody. Oh, yes. We'll say happy Valentine's Day from Dragon to all the boys and girls. Bye now.